The moment has finally come. Today, we're gonna take this rat's nest of network equipment and tangled wires in a cheap IKEA cupboard and transform it into this beautiful server rack. It will take less space, be much neater, easily upgradable, repairable, and expandable. And the best part? It won't even break the bank. At least comparatively speaking. Server equipment is still pretty expensive, even if you buy used. So join me on this roller coaster of emotions, during which I do as many things wrong in one video as possible. No, seriously, if you're a system integrator, a sysadmin, or something like that, don't watch this video. It will hurt. So last year, I built my ultimate small form factor home server. It was based on the ASRock C236 WSI motherboard and an Intel i3-6100. It currently has 4 hard drives in it, 2 SATA SSDs and 2 NVMe SSDs that I use for video editing. With 10GB networking, I can comfortably edit 4K ProRes footage off of it, and it helps to free up the space on my laptop. However, as my home network grew, managing it in an IKEA closet became more and more inconvenient. For instance, I had 3 network cables going into my main home server slash NAS machine only, and that's a lot of cables with no way to manage them. Plus, the case that I used for my NAS was just something left over from my desktop PC. Even though it can theoretically fit as many as 6 full-size hard drives and 12 2.5-inch drives, it isn't really made for NAS use. For instance, replacing or adding new hard drives in it was a nightmare. So I started looking for a rack mount enclosure to house my server. I know that I mentioned that I don't want a rack mounted case because they're loud, and I was wrong. As you'll see in this video, rack components don't have to be loud. So I decided that I want a 3U case with hot swap storage bays. And I found out pretty quickly that they're all prohibitively expensive. Since I live in a small city, I also couldn't find anyone selling an enclosure locally. I almost gave up on the idea until one day I saw a listing on eBay for this Supermicro SC833 enclosure. For $119, it came with 8 hot swap hard drive bays, 1 internal 3.5-inch bay, and a power supply. The only caveat is that it didn't come with any rails, so I had to buy that myself. With the main part of my home lab taken care of, let's talk about the rack itself. So during my extensive research, aka 5 minutes on Amazon, I found this Samsung 12-unit rack for musical equipment. I looked at the price, said, I guess I could afford that, and added it to my wishlist. What I did not take into account is the fact that this rack is only 46 centimeters deep, and most server enclosures, including the Supermicro SC833 case, are at least 65 centimeters deep. After some further research, I came across this 12U rack from StarTech. At 277 euros, it was 2 times more expensive than the Samsung rack, but it's built like a tank and has adjustable rails with different depth settings. The reason why I went with an open rack design is because full-blown rack closets are actually even more expensive. This one, for example, is 385 euros, and this one is 350. Both of those closets are 80 centimeters deep with no way to adjust the depth, and in general, an open rack would just be more convenient to work on and provide better airflow for the components. Building the rack was kind of like building IKEA furniture, but easier. It came with pretty easy instructions, and the whole process took me around 40 minutes. This is what the end result looks like, and with the rack taken care of, let's build our server. First, I had to prepare the enclosure itself. It arrived in pretty good condition and still had all the original parts, including the fans and the power supply, so that had to be fixed. There's nothing wrong with the stock fans installed in rack servers like this one. However, you have to keep in mind that those servers are made to be used in data centers, where the most important things are static pressure, airflow, and ensuring that the components are running as cool as possible. Same goes for the power supply. I'm sure that there's gonna be a lot of angry people in the comments, absolutely furious at me for removing the Supermicro power supply, the pinnacle of industrial server hardware, and replacing it with a measly Corsair SF450. But once again, the power supply that this case came with had a loud fan in it, and it only had 80 plus gold rating, whereas the fan in my Corsair SF450 only ramps up under heavy load, and the power supply has 80 platinum rating, which will definitely help with the power efficiency. I won't be using this server in the data center, it will be standing right next to my desk, and because of that, low noise and power efficiency are much more important to me. So out went the fans and the power supply and the fan bracket. Then it was time to take the server out of the old case. Not much to say here, this case is not the easiest to work in, but I pretty much know it inside out at this point. I connected the SATA cables to the backplane, as well as my PCIe devices, the 10GB network card and the SSD adapter. I'm using this PCIe bifurcating riser, which basically splits a PCIe X16 slot into two slots, X8 and X4, and also gives you an M.2 slot to put your SSD into. For the fans, I used 3 Noctua NF812 X25 fans. There were no mounting holes for 120mm fans in the case, so I used the only proper way to fix fans in an industrial server enclosure. Zip ties. Don't say I didn't warn you. After mounting the third fan, I realized that it won't spin freely because of this metal post. So I took care of it. And there we go. All 3 fans are secured to the case and spin freely. Once again, I wouldn't do any of this if you're actually building a server for any kind of serious mission critical application, data center use, or anything like that. The reason why I went with this janky fan setup and an SFX power supply is because my server rack will be standing right next to my desk and I'm using it at home, not in a data center. Even when picking the components, I made a conscious choice to go with low noise, low heat and low power consumer hardware, and don't worry, I did a lot of testing and monitoring afterwards to make sure that all my components are running cool. Finally, shout out to this ridiculous proprietary front panel connector. I didn't have any male to female jumper wires, so I just cut the other end completely and used a multimeter and this scheme that I found on the internet to map the connections. One thing that definitely got the professional enterprise makeover that it deserved were the hard drives. I initially started off with shucked SMR drives from WD MyBooks and ran MergerFS / SnapRate combo for my storage array. But this time around, I wanted to do everything the proper way and set up ZFS. So I reached out to Western Digital and they actually agreed to send me 4 of their 8TB Western Digital Red Pro hard drives. Those drives are CMR, so they'll work really well in a ZFS setup, and I'm actually thinking about switching to TrueNAS now that I can actually use ZFS. So thank you Western Digital for sponsoring this video and providing the drives. Unfortunately, I didn't manage to get a lot of footage of me actually putting stuff in the rack, so I'm gonna show you what it looks like now and walk you through all the components that I installed on it. First off, I got this nice wooden top from a hardware store and put it on top of the rack to kind of hide my poor cable management. And as an added bonus, I can actually put stuff on it. So the power strip is probably one of the easiest one of the bunch. There are a lot of rack mountable power strips for sale and I went with this one, mostly because it had the power plugs on the rear. I installed it on top of the rack as you can see and it was pretty much it. The only annoying thing is that the European power plugs are oriented diagonally and a lot of devices have those massive power bricks. Because of that, one power brick can basically block 3 ports including the 2 that are adjacent to it, which is not ideal. I'm definitely going to invest into an actual UPS at some point in the future, but for now this power strip has been doing its job pretty well. Next, the patch panel. I needed some way to manage all of those network cables for devices that don't have any front-facing Ethernet ports, such as my NAS or the CTM4 router board. So I got the 16-port patch panel from D-Lock. I didn't actually know that you needed a special tool to punch in the wires in the patch panel, and I just used a flathead screwdriver and some cutters. Don't do it though, just buy the tool. Or better yet, buy a Keystone patch panel. They're usually on the expensive side, but trust me, it's worth it. Next up, the switch. I was using a TP-Link and managed PoE switch and this Microtech 4-port SFP Plus switch for my 10 gig connectivity. But since I wanted untagged VLANs, I needed something smarter than that. I decided to go with this Microtech CRS-326 switch. It is passively cooled, has 24 gigabit ports and 2 SFE Plus ports, and consumes around 5 watts at idle, with no ports connected. The SWOS web interface is also super nice and simple, which is great. Can't say the same about RouterOS, unfortunately. Some people might wonder why I didn't go with the UniFi switch, and UniFi gear is nice, but an equivalent 24-port rack mount switch from Ubiquiti would cost me 431 euros. Since the patch panel and the switch were so close together, I wanted to make some short custom cables to make the rack look a little bit nicer. I didn't really have any luck with that. None of the cables that I made worked, and the cable tester also reported a bunch of faulty contacts. So I gave up and bought a pack of these super thin and super short LAN cables from Amazon, and they've been working great. Next we got this short one U shelf that houses my Raspberry Pis. This is my CTM4 router board that runs Home Assistant, Internal Reverse Proxy, Grafana, and Prometheus. And somewhere in the depth of the shelf there's also a regular Raspberry Pi that I use to run PiKVM. Next up we got my main router, Fujitsu S920. I've made a video about it which I'm going to link in the top right corner. It's an amazing and inexpensive OpenWRT machine. It consumes very little power and has been working really great so far. It's about as powerful as the Raspberry Pi 4, but unlike Raspberry Pi 4, it's cheaper and easier to get, at least here in Europe, and has a PCI Express X4 slot. It's also a good option for running Home Assistant, Plex, and other self-hosted applications. Below the router and the Pis, we got the Drawer of Shame. It's basically just my ISP router. Next, we got 2U of just empty space, and below that is my main server. Now, the main server is the heaviest rack module that I have, so I put it at the bottom of the rack. I made a mistake of buying a pair of these universal rack rails, and don't get me wrong, they do a decent job of holding the enclosure in the rack, but getting the server out of the rack is a huge pain in the butt. This is because the enclosure lid is just wide enough to fit into the rack, and the rails are actually wider than the enclosure. So in order to take it out, I pretty much have to unlatch the lid, tilt it a little bit, and take the whole thing out. I'm definitely going to invest into the original Supermicro rails for that enclosure at some point in the future. So there you have it, this is my virginity corner containing almost my entire home lab, and I've been pretty happy with it so far. It's definitely easier to work on than what I had before, and even though it's bigger in size, it's way more expandable. And since I live in a bigger apartment now and my home lab has expanded in size anyway, I'm okay with it. So that's going to be for this video, and as usual, I would like to thank my patrons. Mitchell Valentino, Carlos Benilla, David Love, Catherine DC, Primus, Ramus Ilyish, Robot Dream of Crypto, and everyone else supports this channel. Thank you guys for watching, and I'll see you in the next one. Goodbye.